In this episode, with global ACH payments, typically there'd be a delay until you received your money. But we're going to be talking about open banking that allows you to get paid instantly. Hey, everybody, welcome back to Subta Studios Live. I'm your host, Chris George, co-founder and chairman of Subta. I'm here, back here with AG from GoCardless, a company that makes it simple to collect reoccurring and one-off payments. AG, thank you so much for being back on the show.
Fantastic to be back, Chris. Thanks for inviting me.
Of course. And so if those of you that didn't see the first episode, we talked about global ACH payments as a payment option for your business. So make sure you go check that out. I think it's really good to have that option and giving your consumers multiple options for making payments. And today we're going to be talking about open banking. So AG, tell us a little bit more about what that term means and how that, you know, how that plays into your business.
Great. Well, open banking is a kind of phenomenon that's happening around the world in different ways. It's kind of coming a lot out of Europe, the UK and the Eurozone especially. And it's really, it really is where third-party providers use APIs to integrate with banks and other financial institutions. So you get other options for managing your money, borrowing your money, or making payments. Now, what you do as a consumer or as a customer is you give consent for this app or this company to be able to interrogate your financial transactions, such as bank statements and payments and so on. Now, in the US, where we are here, it's not really federated in the same way, but it is taking off in a different way through banks themselves individually, but also then through third-party products like Plaid. So, which is embedded in GoCardless. So the actual capabilities are quite similar around the world. And they change a number of things that you would normally have with payments. They allow instant first payment from a bank account. They have a verified mandates for recurring payments. Open banking adds features that really transform the way that two bank accounts connect to each other. Historically, it was pieces of coins and cash, credit cards, wire transfers. But open banking is a direct kind of connection that you as a consumer are allowing to happen between the vendor and yourself.
Is this common? Is this becoming more and more common? How does this benefit the brand and the consumer? Can you sort of walk me through that a little bit more?
Well, it's been out for a while in Europe, and it is getting pretty common as an option. Okay, so but in particular, there are certain types of services where it particularly lends itself well to. And they're typically your subscription services. With a subscription service, one of the challenges is if your customers are paying on credit card, credit cards are expensive. They churn quite a lot. They run out of credit. They lose them or they change them. And so 11% of payments are turning to churn. This is according to Forrester. So there are challenges with credit cards. And quite often, like with streaming services, with like delivery services, on-demand services, and so on, you're only offering credit card. And so offering another option there is an enormous benefit. That's one thing. But the other thing, so you get instant payment, you get less churn. You're also catering to preference in most of Europe and Australasia, for instance. Number one preference in the US is credit cards. But, ACH is still getting up there as well. It is a good option. So if you're not offering it, then, you're actually missing out on part of the market, because there are many countries where the number of adults that have a credit card is less than 50%, like Italy, for instance, and Spain, big populations. So you're catering to preference, that will increase conversion rate. So conversion rate, lower churn, lower cost. What open banking does is allow the immediate delivery of the service, which bank debit before has never allowed, because you've got this handshake in between the two banks. You remember filling out the utility bills and all the rest of it, and you post it in, and then, 6 days later, it's good to go. They know where you live, obviously, because they can go get the money or cut the service. But it's not the same for streaming, digital services, physical subscriptions like, food delivery services, on demand like Uber and so on. So this enables that, open banking enables that kind of service immediately on checkout.
So what has to happen to get this for your business and for the consumer, right? Because I think that's critical for the on-demands to have the open banking and have the ACH ability. So how do they adopt? How do both the brands and the consumers adopt this?
Well, what we're finding, the areas of the preference for bank debit, connecting to bank accounts through a bank debit, that is, if there's already a preference for that for a lot of types of services, this is just incrementally adding on better functionality, because it allows you to have a verified mandate. It's definitely their bank account. We verified it. And then we can then interrogate the balance, and then we can take an immediate first payment. So we're good to go with the payment. I mean, that's all credit cards are doing, as you do your swipe.
They're checking the credit limit.
And we're just giving consent for that to happen with our bank account with another method. So on your phone, you've got your credit card, you've got your PayPal. Now, this could be an option, and you go through the checkout in the same way. And what you do is it's usually biometric. So you'll go into, okay, I want to buy, I'm going to use bank debit. You go like that. Check into Chase or whoever your bank is. Yes, we're good to go. And ping, we're good. And then it happens. What we've done in the background there, we've captured those details. We've put an authorization on that bank account, and we've got a secure mandate. So then every day of the same day of the month or week or a year, on that day, we'll pull the money out of that customer and stick it in the merchant's bank account. We'll do that globally. So we'll pull money out of an Italian bank account, turn it from euros into dollars and land it into a US merchant in LA, for instance. So that's what the way we do it. We do that for about 900 customers today.
Is there like a minimum monthly recurring amount that's too small for this sort of business? Or does not matter, you think, across the board? The large payments, it makes more sense, but like how about small on the lower end size?
We should kind of say, look, offer credit cards, PayPal, and the next best option is this. If we look at it through the lens of, we're in danger in the US of looking at it through the lens of, okay, credit cards is everywhere. No, we think it's the next best option after those ones. And in a B2B world, well, it's a hell of a lot better than sending physical checks and wire transfers. When you expand internationally and you say, send me the dollars to this bank account in New York to someone who's in New Zealand, they'll say, well, yeah, let me get around to you. And you'll be wearing long day sales outstanding receivables, and you'll have a team chasing them. And there's a much better way.
What advice would you give to some of these subscription brands that are looking to expand outside of the US?
Well, most of them will be using a billing platform, specifically for subscriptions, and Zuora, Recurly, Chargebee, Chargeify. There's a load of them. Every single one of those that I've mentioned over 250 have Go Cardless in their app store already embedded in the product. So the barrier to actually trying this is extremely low. It's a configuration. TripAdvisor went live in a few hours, to give you an idea. You can turn it on. You can add it onto your page in the checkout, or if you're a B2B business, you can actually just add a link into the invoice. They click on the link in the invoice, and they'll pay that way, and we'll capture that detail. We'll put a secure mandate on them, and you're away, and you can go. When you do that, you'll find it's just an option. And with our pricing, you can start with no commitment, just sign up online and try it. And then there's different, as you get bigger and larger, organizations need different pricing around the world. But they're a very small business. It's like a consulting business with just 20 customers. They can start with it.
Well, AG, thanks so much for being on. For those of you listening, key takeaway here, offering global ACH, having open banking is a really good option for your business. Giving consumers alternate payment options is always a good idea. And when you're expanding internationally, a lot of these countries, this is the preferred way of payment. So I think it's a no-brainer for you. AG, real quickly, why don't you tell everybody how Go Cardless helps brands and how they can get a hold of you?
So we are gocardless.com. So we're the leading kind of recurring payment provider who specializes on bank debit. I actually moved to the US when we had a funding round where Google and Salesforce invested in us, and Google actually sit on our board. We're not replacing credit cards. We're not replacing wire transfer. Mm-hmm. We're just saying you might find this will get you more business, and it will be more profitable business, and your LTV and CAC ratio will improve. And so just try it.
Amazing. Thank you again, everybody, for watching. AG, thank you again for being on the show and being a great Subto partner. I look forward to chatting with you soon.